first set of lectures in the nonlinear MPC course. And we're happy to have Saša Raković here to give this first part of the course. I will not give a lengthy introduction, but I'll just state that we're very happy to have Saša here. He's been one of the main contributors to development of MPC over almost the last 2 decades, I suppose.
Sounds scary. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having me here. I really appreciate it. So there will be a set of lectures that we'll go over, and there will be a set of MATLAB exercises we'll go over. Just before we start, some of the lectures might sound a bit, may look a bit scary because they do have some mathematical equations, and I'm not so sure if you're from a mathematical background or engineering background, but all of these are transparently converted to the MATLAB code, and you'll see when you do the MATLAB exercises that actually the things that we'll be talking about are implementable relatively easily. Now, before we do that, I need to know how many of you will have laptops for the exercise sessions. We'll have a sessions in the morning and in the afternoon. The idea is to have a 3 sessions lectures and 2 sessions exercises, but this might be rearranged. So I think the 2 morning sessions will be lectures. In the afternoon, we will have flexibility. So for today, for example, I was planning to do 2 lectures and then 2 exercises and then 1 more lecture in the end. Of course, for us to do exercises, we would need to have some, if you have a laptop with MATLAB, do you have a laptop with MATLAB? Okay, so is it too much of a trouble for you to bring it for the afternoon? Okay, so then we'll be set up. I will be asking you to install one of the toolboxes, which is MPT toolbox. Is anyone familiar with this toolbox? Okay, so I'll give you details in the afternoon. MPT toolbox. I think the address is mpt3.org, but I'll give you in the afternoon, first session, we'll install this and play around, get familiar with it before we go on. The toolbox has a lot of routines from computational geometry that actually, if we were to develop, we would be doing actually a course on computational geometry rather than the control. So there is a lot of things that actually I will not be mentioning. This will be used given a priori. The toolbox is relatively easy to use, and for what we need to use, for what we need, I think it's going to be quite useful. Now, the other thing I should say is that actually I have created a Google account for this course, and for the course, I'll be giving the course at the other places as well, but for this course. At the course, there is a literature which is already uploaded. I'm not so sure if Tor Arne has sent you a link so you can actually access the literature. If he hasn't, I will. There is also a folder with the lectures, so all slides that I'll go over will be actually, they're available online, but I'll make them available after we finish the lectures, and you'll have them for your use. Now, in order for me to do that, I would need to know your email address. So you can actually send me an email, maybe with the subject line NTNU Tube MPC course, and with your name, to either my personal email address or to the address for the course. So actually, but to keep confusion, let's do it to my personal. So my email is sasa.v.raković@gmail.com. Okay, once I have your emails, after the lectures are done, typically in the end of the day, in the evening, I'll just send you a link so you can download those lectures. Okay. All right. So, perhaps the other thing that I would like to know, so it's sasa.v.raković@gmail.com. The other thing I would like to know is your background. So how many of you actually comes from a kind of engineering background, and what kind of engineering do you come from? Is it mostly electrical engineering, or is it a mixture? How many of you comes from electrical engineering? Okay. Mechanical? Computer science?
Cybernetics.
So computer science then.
More control.
Okay, so how much of exposure to maths did you have? Not very much. Okay,
a lot.
Okay, so then I'm in trouble. I wrote some easy maths. Okay, so the course has, roughly speaking, 15 lectures. There are 2 days, maybe 2.5 days, that actually will cover some basics in the control, especially in the control under constraints and control under constraints and uncertainty. We'll be looking at exact solutions and why exact solutions to many of these problems are complex. And that will motivate development of specific techniques for a kind of robust model predictive control or model predictive control under uncertainty, which will be tube model predictive control. So the perhaps the place where to start is to ask, what does it mean to be able to control the system? And that property is called controllability. Since you have such a great background in control, can you actually tell me what controllability is? In the case of the linear time invariant systems, discrete time setting. What would be controllability? Did you come across that notion? Okay.
Ability to control all, the perfect word, but all states of the system, all possible results.
Okay, so that's close enough. So typically what you would have a goal, which would be a target state, and you would have an initial state. And controllability would be ability to transfer the initial state to the target state. Obviously, this property depends on the properties of the system. And in the linear case, when you don't have any constraints, when you don't have any constraints, this is merely property of the matrix pair A and B. Okay, so in general, when you have a constraint, however, that property doesn't hold. Now, don't get scared. We'll go through slides slowly. So if you're dealing with a discrete time, typically x plus denotes the state at the next point in time, x denotes the current state, and u denotes the control. We'll have constraints. The pair xu will belong to certain set u, and we'll have a target set xf. So the first question you would like to ask yourself, if I give you a target set, what is the set of the states that actually I can control to a target set? That's exactly what your colleague was saying. It's ability to transfer the system from one position to another position. So the very basic question is to ask, actually, if I'm a given target set, what kind of constraints does this impose on the system dynamics, and what kind of initial conditions I can actually control to a target set? Now, what would that mean? Well, essentially, if we have this kind of condition, if we want our state at the next point in time to be in target set, actually what we are writing condition on f of xu to be in a target set xf. But if you look at this, this is nothing else than the pre-image of a set xf under the function f. So essentially, you would have to invert the set xf under the function f to figure out what would be the pairs of xu. Now, of course, because you have a constraint, you have to restrict that to the state constraints. And that would be essentially pre-image restricted to the end. Now, this notion actually tells you, if I want to solve the problem of going to a target set in one step, I have to characterize the pairs of the states and controls such that actually I'm satisfying my constraints and I'm landing up in the terminal constraint set. Once I have this set in the XU space, I can actually work out one-step controllable set. Now, what would be one-step controllable set? Well, that would be set of all states, x, for which I can find the control, u, such that I satisfy constraints as imposed on the system, and actually I land up in a terminal constraint set xf. It's a kind of scary notation, but actually what it says that one-step controllable set is a projection of the restricted pre-image of the set XF. All what it tells you, it tells you that actually there is no magic about this. Once you specify constraints, target set, and the dynamics, everything is pure mathematics. It's just essentially pre-image and projection. Now, If you know what is the pre-image, if you know what is the one-step controllable set, the next question for you is, when can you solve actually problem? So now, what would be one-step controllability to a given target set problem? That problem would be actually to determine the set of initial conditions for which you can make one-step transition to a target set XF, and that would be first step. So when can we solve this problem? Obviously, to solve this problem, we have to be with initial condition in the one-step controllable set. Now, that means that essentially we have to have a possibility for one-step controllable set to be non-empty, and our state has to be in C. Now, what can we say about this object? What properties would you like to know about this thing? Would you like to know if this thing is bounded, compact? Presumably, we would be computing these sets and would be storing them in a computer. In order to describe them and to have them stored in a computer or an electronic device, we need to know some properties. And in this sense, what is the most interesting is actually when it comes down to the control synthesis, as it will be shown on the next slide, what you really need to know, you need to know what can we say when this object will be closed, bounded, compact. So typically, when we come back to the system, through this course, we'll be mostly dealing with the continuous systems. I presume that actually I don't have to explain what continuous function means. We'll be dealing with the closed, at the times compact constraints, as well as closed or compact target sets. Now, closed means that the sequences converge in the set. Compact means closed and bounded. So, those are the basic. Did you come across with these notions in the course? You did? Okay, good. So we can say when this property of being closed merely comes from the continuity of F and the closeness of the XF. When XF is closed and F is continuous, pre-image is closed. When Y is closed, intersection of two closed sets is a closed set. So under continuity of F, closeness of X, F, and Y, we can guarantee that the pre-image restricted to Y is a closed set.
What does pre-image mean?
It's just precisely defined here. So pre-image is a set of all points which are mapped to a given target set. So in this particular case, one-step controllability to a given target set problem actually requires you to determine all initial conditions X for which you can find the control U, which satisfy constraints, and which evolve under your control to the target set XF. Now, if you replace XF with F of XU, this condition becomes nothing else than this. When you look at this definition, this is nothing else than actually pre-image of a set XF under the function F. Okay. So it will become, okay, there are examples. I mean, it gets scary. I choose intentionally hard slides to scare you off so that after today, those who are interested stay and those who are not interested leave. I'm joking. Okay, so now, in either case, the fact that the set is closed in a specific space, once you do projection of a closed set, doesn't mean you'll get a closed set. So for that reason, at the times, we'll invoke compactness. Now, what does that mean? It means if you have a compact constraints or actually bounded pre-image, then actually the one-step controllable set is compact. Now, second question you're going to ask yourself, okay, so if I have a one-step controllable set, I know all states for which actually I can find the control to go to a target set, what are the controls that actually work? And if you look at this definition, what you're going to ask, at any point in a one-step controllable set, you're asking yourself, what are the controls, which, of course, what they have to accomplish? They have to satisfy constraints, and they have to evolve to the target set XF. So this is the definition of the one-step controllable map. Now, typically, a control function is a function that you actually implement, like a state feedback, like LQR, DLQR, LQG, H-infinity control. They're just control functions. A control function solves one-step controllability to a given target set, if and only if, at any point in this controllable set, actually it belongs to this set valued map. This map is called regulation map. Now, to make it more interesting for you, let's actually work out one example before we go to polyhedral set. Let's take a linear system very simple. X plus is X plus U. Constraints, X goes between minus 10 and 10, and U goes between minus 1 and 1, and your target set is 0. So the first question, without constraints, you would ask yourself, what are the states that actually go to one step to a 0? That defines the line X plus Y equals X plus U, sorry, equals to 0. Now, because you do have a constraints between minus 10 and 10 in X direction, and between minus 1 and 1 direction, there is intersection. So this specific piece here is a restricted preimage of a target set, which is 0. Okay, if you go back to the definitions, this object, preimage, would be nothing else than this whole line. Of course, this line expands, it doesn't stop there. Okay, it's a subspace. Now, if you think about the restricted preimage, it's intersection with the constraints. Okay? So we are taking intersection with the state and control constraints. So it's only this piece of a line. So this is a collection of the pair, this is a collection of XU points for which actually we end up in a target set, which is in this case point 0. And then effectively to find the controllable set, we find that actually it's a projection to X direction, which is minus 1 and 1. Now, for any point between minus 1 and 1, what is our strategy to go to 0? You can look at the equation, you can say, well, it's very simple, I'll just choose U equals minus X, and you make it 0. But effectively what it means you're lifting your set state X to this line, and actually that gives you equation X plus Y equals to 0. So the functions that actually do the trick in this particular case is just singular functions U equals minus X. That's how I constructed this example to begin with. We'll see the next example. Now, this is nothing special than actually working with the affine polyhedral setting. I believe that you have acquired a lot of knowledge about the linear systems. If this C bothers you, forget about it. Often in calculations we'll have a C0, but it doesn't change any of the equations. So when the system is affine, it means it's given by the matrices A, B, and C, AX plus BU plus C. Constraints, when they're given in the form of linear inequalities, as they're often given, if you think about it, the pressure has to be below a certain level. Temperature has to be in certain range. The profit has to be above a certain level. So quite often, a lot of physical problems and physical constraints can be written in terms, not all, but a lot of them can be written in terms of polyhedral. Now, this algebra here is just applied algebra to this specific case. In this particular case, our function f of x u is ax plus bu. Our target set is gx. So instead of x, you're writing ax plus bu plus c, gax plus gbu, less or equal h. This gc has gone to the other side. These are the constraints. So preimage becomes polyhedral set. If you start from polyhedral sets, by the way, these sets described by finite number of linear inequalities, or if you will, affine inequalities, are called polyhedral sets. If they are bounded, they are called polytopic sets. Okay. So if you have a polyhedral structure and we take a fine system, preimage is polyhedral. Projection of polyhedral set is a polyhedral set. So if we start from a polyhedral structure, we'll retain polyhedral structure of one-step controllable set. Why this matters? This matters because if you look at this example, we started from 0 and we easily determined the set minus 1 and 1. So essentially it helps us describe these sets. So starting from xf to be point 0, we obtain that one-step controllable set is minus 1 and 1. And now this example also illustrates that it's quite different when you deal with a constrained and unconstrained controllability. In unconstrained controllability, you could have controlled the whole space in one step to 0. Because this system is controllable. It's one-dimensional and you can choose a U. So if you don't have a constraints, any point with a function y equals minus x is actually driven to 0. So you achieve perfect controllability in one step. However, because you have a constraints, if I give you point 2, you cannot control it in one step to 0. The best you can do is in two steps. Okay. Now, that would be controllability. More importantly, if you look at what was our control map? Our control map was a set of all points which was actually lying in the pre-image set. So if you look at the u of x in the polyhedral case, you'll move cx to the other side, you'll move gax to the other side, and you'll get that actually your control map is polyhedral set. Importance of polyhedral set means that actually you can find a good control by solving set of linear inequalities. Now, solving sets of linear inequalities can be done quite efficiently, sometimes even by hand, but typically by linear programming. And you have encountered linear programming by now. Now, if I talk too fast, or I talk too, if my voice is too low, just stop me and ask me to either increase the volume of my voice or talk faster. Here's the, oh, slower. I meant slower. So you're still listening. Okay, it's good. It's working. All right, so here it is. So if you look at the algebra, in this particular case, we have minus 10, 10, minus 1, 1. We can write this as a linear inequalities. It's very easy. Our target set can be written as a two linear inequalities or as equality, whatever you like. If you look at the pre-image set, okay, so this is intersection with the constraints, and this is the condition to be in a terminal set. This is restricted pre-image. So, as we know on this graph, there is intersection of this line, so this limits the points between minus 1 and 1 in terms of the x. So this is the pre-image. We need to project this one down. And if you project this down, essentially it means taking those two extreme points and projecting it to the x, which gives you minus 1 and 1. And in this particular case, as it turns out, the only feedback that works is u of x equals minus x. Okay. Of course, you can rewrite that function in many ways. Now, if you understand one-step controllability under constraints, what is a more ambitious objective? A more ambitious objective then is actually to go multi-stage or more steps. Now, if you want to go more steps, what is essentially what you want to do? You want to do n-step controllable, to characterize n-step controllable set and related control function. But effectively, what problem are we solving? We are solving the problem of controlling this system with the state feedbacks, satisfying constraints over the horizon from 0 to n minus 1. So these are the constraints which come from the constraint set, and these are dynamic constraints, or dynamical consistency. And essentially, we land in a terminal set XF, or a target set XF. Now, if at the end of your horizon of stage of n steps, you land in a terminal set XF, that means your Xn is inside of the XF. What can you tell me about Xn minus 1? In the previous step, what we did say, in order to solve one-step controllability to a target set problem, the states that could control to a target set in one step were only members of the one-step controllable set. So if you know that Xn is inside of the target set XF, what can we say about Xn minus 1?
Has to be in one-step controllable set.
So if Xn, if we call XF X0, if we reverse the time, then actually Xn minus 1 has to be in one-step controllable set to the target. Okay. Now, if Xn minus 1 was in that set, X1, what can we say about Xn minus 2? So by the same token, forget about indexing. If this point is inside of this set, in order to control it to that point, we have to be in a one-step controllable set. So now bring back indices. Xn minus 2 has to be in X2, which is a one-step controllable set to the one-step controllable set. So what we are generating dynamics of these controllable sets. So it's a semi-group property. So you can continue this chain of conclusion to figure out that actually in order to control, to solve this problem, the state X0 has to be in n-step controllable set, which is computed recursively. Okay. Now, this means the following. if you look at this problem without specifying everything, it means that actually we are looking at something which is called dynamic programming recursion. We have generated dynamics of controllable sets. Xk plus 1 is some function c of xk with initial condition x not equals xf. Now, this looks scary, and you say, okay, great. This is dynamics of sets, how I'm going to compute that? And for that purpose, we'll do this exercise in the afternoon. And for that purpose, actually, we do need to have some structure of the sets and the system so that we actually can represent these sets in a nice way. Okay. So you would iterate one-step controllable sets n times from your target set and work out what is the set of controllable states. All iterations that you generate will form something which is known as a controllable tube. And then the same conclusion follows, because we had this chain of equivalences. What you can say that n-step controllability to a target set xf is solvable if and only if xn is non-empty and your initial condition belongs to the xn. Now, let's go back to the example to see what happens here. So now, this is the same example, n steps. And this is, say, iteration number 3. Your target set is minus 3 and 3. The constraints are between minus 10 and 10, and between u is between minus 1 and 1. So dynamical constraints becomes x plus u between minus 3 and 3. This gives you this strip in the xu space. Intersection with the constraints gives you this object with all points inside. That object is a polytopic object. It's a set described by finitely many inequalities, and it's bounded. Now, in order to get a one-step controllable set, you need to project to the x-space. You're taking the extreme points of this object, projecting down, and you're getting the set minus 4, 4. So in order to go to the set between minus 3 and 3, given these dynamics and given these constraints, your initial condition has to belong between minus 4 and 4. And indeed, when your initial condition is 4, you have to implement control minus 1 to move the system to 3. Any other control will not drive it to the target set. When you're at minus 4, you have to implement the control plus 1 to go to the minus 3. Okay. But what are the good controls? So the good controls, if you take a specific point, minus 2.5, the good controls are all points which lie in this segment. This segment is, as previously described by linear inequalities. Apparently, at 0, you can implement any control between minus 1 and 1 and still say between minus 3 and 3, which makes sense, because essentially, when I'm at 0, between minus 1 and 1, I'm still smaller than 3 and bigger than minus 3, no matter what control I implement. However, what really matters, you see, as you go to the extreme points of the set, you have to be very careful with choosing controls. When you're at 4, it tells you, well, u has to be minus 1. When you're at minus 4, u has to be a single point, which is 1. Now, what is the other conclusion you can tell me based on this image? What kind of functions can you use to ensure controllability for one-dimensional systems? Now, it turns out that controllable sets become polytopic in this particular case. Now, this would be, if it connect those two extreme points with a line, what kind of function do we get? If you just draw a line from here to here, that would be a line in xu space, which would give a linear dependence of x on u, of u on x. So, or affine, it depends where it passes. But essentially, it turns out that affine functions in the linear case for one-dimensional problems can solve these problems. Unfortunately, this conclusion is not true for higher dimensional systems due to the geometry. Now, this gives you an idea. And let me give you one more thing, OK? Derivation. Again, you do the same steps. You go from a description of your restricted pre-image, OK? You do projection to obtain one-step controllable set. And then you characterize this one-step control map. And you see that the control has to be between two values, which actually collapse and become a single point at these extreme points. Now, if you really look at a complete solution, the set of points we can control to 0 is between minus 1 and 1. And we can check that by inspection, really. any point between minus and 1 and 1, because we are choosing u between minus 1 and 1, can be driven to 0. Just take u equals minus x. If we want to go to a set between minus 1 and 1, at the next point we have to be between minus 2 and 2. Okay, and you can see that actually in the region between minus 1 and 1, it doesn't matter what you do with the control, but when you're higher than 1, you have to push the controls inside of 1. When you're smaller than minus 1, you have to push controls inside of the minus 1. So the controls on the negative side would be plus 1, for example. The controls on positive side would be minus 1. In between minus 1 and 1, anything you like to apply. Of course, you'll select the control in some smart way. And if you continue this, you actually figure out that for this specific example, in 10 steps, you can control the whole space, constraint space. Okay. Now, this is in a strong contrast, once again, in a strong contrast to unconstrained controllability. In unconstrained controllability, because the system is one-dimensional, you would be able to control every point in one step. Ramification of this is twofold. Essentially, the first ramification is that actually, even though the system may be linear, presence of constraints render the problem non-linear. Even though the system is essentially quite simple, one-dimensional, determining the sets may require you to do some calculation rather than actually just claiming it's a whole space in one set. Now, okay, let's go back and see actually what happens now with the... Now, because you have characterized these controllable sets, which I just shown you, you can actually characterize the related control maps. So, for any point in the set xk, you have to select the controls which actually drive the system to the xk minus 1 controllable sets. Now, if you look at this, characterization gives you the sequence of control maps. These are control functions. Now, once again, to go back here, this object would be graph of these control maps. So at any x, this would tell you what is the set of admissible controls. So it's a set, it's not a point. And it changes with x, okay? It goes from these smaller intervals, at this point in time becomes the whole interval, and then again it goes to a smaller interval. You can see that it changes continuously as you move x on one or the other side. That's a property of polyhedral structure. Okay, so we have that, and by the token of how we solve the one-step control problem, yeah? So the feedback that was selected had to satisfy property of belonging to the set of admissible controls. If you look at the control policy, which is the sequence of control functions, so if at time 0 we wish to implement control function k0, at time 1 k1, at time n minus 2 kn minus 2, or kappa, I call it k, but it should be kappa really, this is Greek letter, kappa n minus 1. So what we know that this relation holds. Now this is reverse indexing. The reason why it's reverse indexing, these controllability sets are constructed backwards in time, but I have enumerated them forwards in time. Okay, if you go to the, so 0, 1, 2, 2, it's 10 step. But actually when you start controlling the system, you'll be going from 10 down to 0. So your time reverses. Okay. Now, the second question then, actually, once we understand these theoretical ramifications, the question is actually when can we compute these things? And for that reason, once again, I'm bringing this affine polyhedral setting. So if you assume, that at iteration k minus 1, we have polyhedral structure, we implement that result, which says if you have a polyhedral structure in an affine system, and we look at one-step controllable set, then we get one-step controllable set which is polyhedral, and we get a set-valued map which is polyhedral. So therefore, xk is going to be gkx less or equal some matrices. Later on this afternoon, we'll be computing these objects, and you'll be getting concrete matrices and concrete sets, much more exciting than this one-dimensional, hopefully, if the toolbox works. And you'll be seeing what these objects are. Okay, so one of the important things why I brought up this polyhedral, affine polyhedral, is that actually we preserve this structure. If we preserve polyhedral structures, we can do computations using polyhedral tools. That's the only reason. Okay. This is the example. Now, so let me ask you one thing. As I wrote here this, uk of xk. If uk is a function of xk, and I'm selecting the sequence, so u0 of x0, u1 of x1, u2 of x2, up to un minus 1 of xn minus 1, what kind of functions am I selecting? Are these open loop or closed loop functions, control functions? So what would be an open loop function if you look at 10-step horizon? Let's think about the following thing. Let's say you are crossing the road. You have two strategies. Now, you can assume that the drivers are responsible and they obey the lights. That's one possibility. And then you look at the lights and you do the thing. But let's say you're crossing the road and there are no lights. So you have to go on your intuition. You look at the road on the left and right and you decide to cross. That would be one strategy. Another strategy is you look left and right every single step you make as you're crossing the road. Which strategy is wiser?
Looking all the time.
Looking all the time. Now, looking all the time corresponds to actually taking action based on the current state of the system. When you look all the time, it means you re-evaluate the situation. You get the new information about the state of the world and you act on it. Deciding a priori and following a priori what you decided from 10 days ago may or may not be good. So if you make an investment in a company for which you hear after 4 days that it's going bankrupt and you stay with your investment, obviously it's not a good decision. But if you were able to reevaluate as you gather new information, then actually you may withdraw your money, maybe minimize your losses or essentially retain your gains up to that point in time. So the difference here is that actually these kind of feedbacks are closed loop feedbacks. So the decision at the time k depends on the knowledge at the time k, not at the time zero. If this was x0 or this was x0, then actually those would be open loop. Now, an important fact in the control, and this is quite surprising, but actually it says that this can be proven. So in open loop control synthesis, control actions are determined at x0. So in the future, no matter how far you look at, you fix the decision what to do today. So you fix the decision what to do tomorrow, day after tomorrow, and so on and so forth. And you stick with that decision. In a closed loop control synthesis, however, you reevaluate decisions at that point in time. Simple way to think of that, you imagine a number of scenarios and you prepare action for each of these scenarios. So you counteract to the possible outcomes. Now, important fact in control theory is that in idealistic scenario, when there is no uncertainty, when there is a perfect knowledge, solutions to the n-step controllability to a target set problem over classes of open loop and closed loop coincide. Meaning that actually if you can solve closed loop problem, you can solve the open loop problem. Or if you can solve open loop problem, you can solve. This is counterintuitive because of the examples I've just given you. But it's not counterintuitive when you take this no uncertainty and there is a perfect knowledge. It means everything evolves as your system says. So you live in an isolated world, nothing can affect it, and everything works perfectly well. Sadly enough, that never happens. And the key to this fundamental observation is the determinism of the model. Now, even in this case, in practical terms, closed loop offers advantages for possible mismatches or whatever happens in the system. Now, they did tell me it's 45 minutes. So let me close this first 45 minutes with questions from you, and then we'll continue with the other parts. Do you have any questions on this part so far? Does that mean everything is clear, or nothing is clear, or my voice is broken, or my story is broken, or I didn't put things logically enough? Please, don't hesitate. I'm not the one to give you marks. I'm the one to help you get good marks.
I'm wondering how one-step controllability relates to if normal linear system that is maybe slow, takes a long time to reach its goal state.
So now I don't know what you mean by normal linear system, but let's suppose that what you mean is a linear time invariant discrete time system with no constraints. So And let's even further simplify. Let's say it's a single input. I'll explain why single input. Then actually, if n is dimension of the system, any state, if the system is controllable, any state in the state space can be transferred to any other state in the state space in at most n steps. That's a controllability property. Now, what it would mean, if you've seen in that example, if you remember that line, x plus u equals to zero, you can still write the equations. So you start from the x zero, you want to go to the xn, or let's say xt. Well, you, first thing you can ask yourself, what are the points I can steer to the xt in one step, yeah? So you would get equation a xt minus 1 plus bu equals xt. And you can call, let's call this axn minus 1, okay? But then actually you can form the equation xn minus 1 equals, let's call this bn minus 1, bun minus 2 plus axn minus 2. So you can back propagate this. And then actually you can substitute to eliminate the x sequences. And what you're going to really get, you're going to get an minus 1 b, an minus 2 b, a b, b times a vector of controls, you know, equals something which is going to depend on this and x0, yeah? So you'll see, in order to find the u which equates to something which is specific, this matrix has to be invertible, and that's where you get the rank condition. Now I said if it's a single, single input system, in a single input system you can do it in n steps. When you have a multiple inputs, then actually there is something which is called controllability index, and this controllability index tells you how many steps you need to generate sufficiently many columns of this so you can invert sub-matrix of this. It's well defined. So essentially, what would be the case? Each of these pre-images would be a hyperplane in that case. And each would be adding another hyperplane. So essentially in a scalar case, as you would expect, in one step you can control the whole. Yep. So if this is not bounded, when you project it down, you cover the whole X line. Now, in two-dimensional case, you would get one hyperplane, which would cover one of the subspaces. Then, if the system is invertible, there will be some kind of rotation, so you would not get the same hyperplane. You would get another hyperplane. When you sum up those two, you would cover the whole space, which would correspond algebraically to the condition of the full rank. So, the difference is in the boundedness, that's number one. And the secondly, that actually it's a geometry of constraints which eliminates the algebraic considerations. Because of the geometry of the constraints, the controllability property may become only local. As it turns out, in this single scalar case, that actually you do need 10 steps. And in some cases, in fact, you may not be even able to control all points in the state space, which are in the constraints. This is a good example. If you, for example, had 2x plus u, then you would have been able to control only points between minus 1 and 1. Everything else would just diverge. Okay. Well, obviously, in an unconstrained case, you just take feedback minus 2x. So the point I wanted to say with this simple example is that once you have constraints, the classical notions don't really apply. Choosing a feedback using traditional methods may or may not work. So there is a procedure how to construct the feedback, which we'll do. Okay. And you'll see that these are the sets. Somebody else had a question.
Isn't the assumption that the n step control set, isn't that assuming the same assumption as you have in open loop problems? That you, because step n minus 1, for step n minus 1 to be able to reach step n, and you have to be able to implement perfectly.
So,
one example. So, I think have a certainty that you're able to reach.
So, I think your argument is very close to dynamic programming argument, and it's very close along the lines where you want to show equivalence of the closed loop and open loop. For the reasons that actually this is not primary part of the course, I needed to extract everything that matters, but not overload you with the proofs and everything. So the proof would go that actually you construct the closed loop, which means you would transverse through certain sets. And then actually, because the system is deterministic, you store this state and control sequences. They become just numbers. Because they are numbers, they can be selected at x0. So that means the trajectory generated with the open loop just goes through the same trajectories of x and u, which are closed loop. Which shows that actually any solution of closed loop can be recovered with the open loop. Okay. Obviously, open loop solutions can be recovered with the closed loop, because if you think about so if I put x0 instead of xk, because xk is in some sense function of x0, so x0 are degenerate. The open loop functions would be degenerate closed loop functions, yeah? Because they lose some information. So that would go along that argument. So the argument is purely the dynamic programming one, that actually you figure out that the tail of your actions has to be optimal when it continues, which as for what I used, if I want to end up in XF at the end stage of the process, that means I have to be in pre-image of that at the stage n minus 1, and so on and so forth. And you propagate this backwards. I think this is a bit, okay, it's a bit non-traditional, and I'm pretty convinced that actually after creating some of these sets yourself in the afternoon, that actually it will become much more tangible. Okay. All right, so 45 minutes, then 15 minutes break. Okay, if you like a break, we take a break, and then we continue with the... Okay, all right. So, just for the future, you can stop me as long as it's reasonable. You can't stop me like 15 minutes during the lecture. I'll try to leave 5 to 10 minutes for any questions, but during the lecture, if you want to ask something, do not hesitate, just ask. I'll try to answer. Okay, thank you.